Well, let's just dive right in. We're jumping into 1 John chapter 5, the last chapter of 1 John. 1 John chapter 5, verses 1 through 12. As you're able, let us stand together. We'll read the scriptures, we'll pray, and then you may be seated. I know you guys just sat down. Sorry about that. 1 John chapter 5, verses 1 through 12. Beginning in verse 1. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God. And everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of Him. By this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and obey His commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not burdensome. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is He who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ, not by the water only, but by the water and the blood. And the Spirit is the one who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. Verse 7, for there are three that testify, the Spirit and the water and the blood, and these three agree. If we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God is greater. For this is the testimony of God, that He has borne concerning His Son. Whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. Whoever does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed, and in the testimony that God has borne concerning His Son. And this is the testimony. God gave us eternal life, and this life is in His Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we thank You for the sobriety of Your word, Lord God, that You do not hold any punches when it comes to truth, Lord Jesus, that You are, even at times, seemingly not delicate, with how You handle truth, Lord Jesus. But Lord Jesus, we thank You so much for Your love that is delicate. Your supreme characteristic of Your love, as You bid us come meet with Me this evening. Lord, we want to meet with You, Lord God, not just in the sense of having some amount of community or unity together. Lord Jesus, we need to hear Your voice speak to us, Lord. We need to hear You say that You love us, Lord God, as You have always loved us. We need to hear You say, come, turn away from sin, come to Me. Lord, we need to hear, Lord Jesus, come to Me, those who are weary and heavy laden, I will give You rest. Lord, we love You, God, and we thank You for Your truth, that Your commandments truly are not burdensome, but they're light, because Your yoke is light. Lord, we want to know more about You. And the best way we can do that is through the study of Your word. So we ask that You do this. Speak to us, Lord God. Lord, truly, as the one that is able to speak the message tonight, may I fall into the background and have Your Holy Spirit be here in my place, Lord God. Lord Jesus, I need to hear from You just as much as all of us here in this room, Lord. As the congregation and fellowship of believers in Jesus, we want to hear from You. In Your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Unburdened obedience is the title of our message tonight. Unburdened obedience. As I said previously, this is John as he's coming somewhat to the close of his epistle to the churches in Asia Minor, the churches in Turkey. And as we come to the conclusion of John's message, what we're going to be doing is, in chapter 5, we're going to be taking two messages. We have two messages left, essentially, in 1 John. And then starting in July, we will be beginning 2 and 3 John, finishing our series in John's epistles, prayerfully, hopefully, at the end of July. And by the end of July, then the starting of August, we'll be starting a new series we're waiting upon the Lord to hear from. And so I hope you guys are excited for that. We just know that if it's in His word, it's going to be good. It's going to be great. So let's just, like I said, let's just jump right in. Unburdened obedience, verses 1 through 2 together in chapter 5 of 1 John. Everyone Some translations say, whosoever, right? Whosoever believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God. And everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of Him. And by this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and obey His commandments. One of the things I love, and I'm sure you guys have caught as we've studied through 1 John, is how easy John makes it to the churches that read his letters. How easy John makes it in knowing what we need to do, what's upon our shoulders to do to follow God. We get these kind of key words that should automatically, when we read them in Scripture, pop in our brains. Oh, I need to pay attention. Especially by verse 2. By this we know, right? That should cause us to look and take attention. Well, what should I know? I should pay attention to the next couple of sentences. That we love the children of God, and when we love God and obey His commandments. And so those are just wonderful, wonderful things. And so as John is concluding here, as he's coming to an end with his first epistle, what I want you guys to be able to also draw attention to is a connection between his conclusion, chapter 5, and his introduction of chapter 1. If you take some time, and we're not going to do this tonight, but you're more than welcome to in devotion time or on your own when you're in your own special time in studying God's Word, is take chapter 5 and read it, and then take chapter 1 and read it, and see how John has bookended essential truths, essential encouragements that are necessary for our life in Christ. Just for an example, jumping from the very first two verses of chapter 5, you can jump back to chapter 1, verses 4 and 5, where he says this, "Whoever says, 'I know him,' but does not keep his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him." Verse 5, "But whoever keeps his word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. By this we may know that we are in him." We remember from last week truly what perfected love actually looks like, and how we have received that perfected love. We embrace that perfect love as imperfect vessels, imperfect people. But through the wonderful mercy, the wonderful grace of Jesus Christ, we also now have the access, the ability to display that perfect love. And how do we do it? Just as it's proclaimed here in verses 1 and 2, by obedience that we give to the Lord. John has spent much of his time in his epistle encouraging the churches in Asia Minor to love one another. We remember we have these three focuses that he tends to just repeat and repeat and repeat over and over again. It was love, obedience, and through love and obedience, the church would have unity together, unity of fellowship in Christ. And he just knocks those over and over and over again, searing in our minds the importance, the magnitude of knowing those three things. Love being the supreme characteristic that defines the church. And because of this love, and because we've been affected by this love, it points to how we should treat others. We remember just from the previous week at the beginning of chapter, at the end of chapter 4, verse 19, we love because He first loved us. He first loved us. He chose to show His love towards us, that while we were yet sinners, He died for us. But there's something that we need to understand here first, that John is illuminating to us again for our remembrance. John, he doesn't want us to miss the forest for the trees and looking at truly what needs to be the ultimate demand for believers in Jesus. Can you see that there, looking at the specific text? The ultimate demand of us above anything else is found in verse 1 of chapter 5. Do you see that there? Everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of Him. Whoever loves the Father loves whoever has been born of Him. The only way, friends, that we have capacity to love God is if we've been born of Him. And in being born of him, we have then the capacity to love others. Without being born of God, there is no opportunity. There's no access to be able to truly love with perfect love those that do not know what love is. John doesn't want to get our Christian life misconstrued in thinking that, you know what, friends, if we just love one another, then we have salvation in Christ, right? First and foremost, we need to have the love of the Father. I know that John has spent a majority of the time focusing and investing. Friends, we need to love one another, love one another, love one another. But here at the end of the conclusion, he says, hold on a second. The only way that you're able to love one another is because you love God. Sometimes it's easier to say, you know what, let's just love one another. It's easier just to say, hey, let's just say I love you, I want to have a relationship with you, instead of standing for the ultimate truth that is demanded from the love and relationship of God. There has been many movements in church history that has fallen wayside because those movements have made an ultimate decision to say, instead of following or instead of obeying God the Father by loving him completely, we're just going to choose instead to love one another. This is somewhat of a hard pill to swallow. To give you an example, there's the Quaker movement. I don't know if you guys have known of the Quaker movement before. The Quaker movement, the Friends movement, have fallen into this, I truly believe. What started in the 1600s, believing that there was this capacity of finding intimacy with God, intimacy with the Holy Spirit, by leading out in true brotherly love, ended up with the heretical doctrine of the Quaker movement of saying, listen, all man is essentially good. All men is essentially good, and even those that are unsaved are children of God, and ultimately, once they come into eternity and they stand before God, his love is just so great that you're going to allow them to come in. Friends, our God's love is so great that he gives us the opportunity to receive him, but he also gives us the opportunity to reject him. We have the capacity to be able to say, God, I want all of you, or God, I want nothing to do with you at all. And every person upon this earth, every soul that has been born and created in the image of God has the capacity to either follow or reject him. And friends, it's a deception from the devil that John has warned us about in previous chapters. It's a deception of the devil that if we simply just love one another, that will be good enough for us to have salvation. John sincerely desires to tell us that this is wrong. I want you to see the emphatic, the emphasis, the clarity that he wants to show us here in the first two verses. I mean, everyone, whosoever believes Jesus is the Christ, in no uncertain terms, Jesus is the Christ, then you have been born of God. And everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of God. There's two magnificent truths in verse 1 to understand what it means to be born of God. To have that evidence, that affirmation to know without a shadow of a doubt that you have a relationship with the God who created you. You see, it's very clear. The first magnificent truth, believing that Jesus is the Christ. John is very emphatic in sharing with the church here. It's not just saying that Jesus was a good person, Jesus was a prophet, or Jesus was even called the Christ. No, it needs to be a public confession of sin, a public confession before everyone. Listen, no, Jesus is the Messiah. He is the Christ. Secondly, then we have the active relationship of God in love. Everyone who loves the Father, that's the second magnificent truth, loving the Father knows that they've been born of him. And this is the way he shares with us. You ever been given directions for something? Something that you might have to build? a wonderful thing about being a missionary is that the first thing that you do when you step down, especially in a European country, and you are dropping your duffel bags, you're looking for a place to rent. Once you find that, the thing that you go, the very next place that you go to is IKEA. Because IKEA is the cheapest furniture. IKEA has no idea how much they've supplied missionaries all over the world because of providing cheap furniture. But as many of you know, IKEA always comes with a set of instructions, right? And there's always this time, especially if you choose you and your wife to partner up and build something together, oftentimes it becomes a lesson in compromise, a lesson in partnership, a lesson in communication. It's all very healthy and it's good. And you come up with extra pieces and then it can become difficult. But usually with IKEA, there's no word directions, it's just pictures, right? It's just pictures laid out. Well, it's supposed to look like this. And then the second step, it's supposed to look like that. And then you try to figure out, well, how did I end up in this place? Isn't there an easier way? Couldn't there be just the clearest understanding that I would know exactly what I need to do? We could do it. It could be efficient. And all of a sudden, there we are. It's a bed frame when we can sleep now. This is what John is essentially saying here. Friends, here's the most efficient way. The absolute best way to love one another. Do you guys want to know that? The absolute best way to love your brother and sister in Christ in the congregation of brothers and sisters. Here's what he says. The absolute best way to love the children of God is to obey his commandments. Is to obey his commandments. Be obedient to his word. Obedience is the best way to love God and to love one another. Think about it in this way. If all of us desired, and I'm sure as believers in Christ, as you're walking with the Lord, all of us have that desire. Lord, I want to perfectly obey you. Me as an imperfect vessel, I know that's impossible, but I want to perfectly obey you. If we got to the point where we were willing to die to ourselves, follow God's will, obey his word, the ultimate result is that the church would have a better environment of love. Because when we love God, we love one another. It just simply trickles out and it flows out. The natural love that we've had for God in relationship to him, as we study his word and as we hear his spirit speaking to us in prayer and supplication before him every morning, we enter into the day ready to love one another because we realize the grand value of first his love for us. Obedience in the relationship with God equals love. Obedience equals love. To give you kind of an illustration about this, this is one I got from Warren Wiersbe, who's a great guy on illustration for the word. He says, a prospective bridegroom was extremely nervous as he and his fiance were discussing their wedding plans with their pastor. And he says, I'd like to see a copy of the wedding vows, the young man said. And the pastor handed him the service and he read it carefully. And then he hands it back and says, this won't do. The pastor says, well, why? And he says, there's nothing written in there about her submitting to me. There's nothing in here about her submitting to me. His fiance turns and smiles at him, as I'm sure as many of our wives have smiled at us before in a knowing way. His fiance smiles, takes his hands, and she says, honey, the word submission doesn't have to be written in this service because it's already written in the love that I have for you in my heart. When we love God, we have a desire to obey him. And when we obey him, his love ever becomes the more potent, the more satisfying, the more fulfilling part of our relationship with God and with one another. Obedient submission to God is the greatest way we can express our love to him. Remember, our love, it's imperfect. But in obedient faith, what happens? As it's declared to us just in the previous chapter, it becomes perfect. Perfect, without flaw, without blemish. Let's continue on in our text, verses 3 through 5, and see what it means to obey God and to love Him in the right way. Verses 3 through 5. For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not burdensome. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Verse 5, who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? Friends, can we just stop and look at the magnitude of verse 3 just for a second? This is the love of God, that we keep His commandments. And here's the wonderful perk, the wonderful quality in obeying His commandments. His commandments are not burdensome. They're not burdensome. I mean, this is the intended focus in the title, Unburdened Obedience. Has there ever been a time when you felt burdened in obeying God? We can be honest with each other. There's been times when I've thought that the obedience to God was burdensome. But let's kind of unpack this and unfold this together to see truly what John means for us to realize about His commandments are not burdensome. Burdensome means heavy. Means something that we don't have the strength or the strength we're unequipped to hold this burden. When it's burdensome upon our shoulders. But friends, His commandments are not like that. It's a promise from His word. They are not like that. A question we can ask ourselves is, did John say that His commandments are not hard? No. He said they weren't burdensome. They are dying to our sin nature every single day. Can that be hard? Most definitely. And I fail every single day. Can they be the active choosing of the Spirit over the flesh? But are they not burdensome? Why? Because His yoke, He puts His yoke upon you, and His yoke is easy, and His burden is light. Do you know why Jesus in the Gospels chose to use that word yoke? Many of us have a picture, a visual picture of our understanding of what a yoke means. Yoking an animal against a wagon, yoking an animal against a plow. In those days of Jesus, the yokes were large pieces of wood, and the yokes were actually carved to fit the body of the animal pulling it. And people, when an animal died or they purchased a new animal, they sure didn't, probably weren't able to use even more money to purchase another yoke to fashion it upon them. So what would they do? They would carve that same yoke again in order to fit that yoke upon the new animal. Thus, the possessive word that Jesus uses in the text, put my yoke upon you. Possessive, my yoke. So how is it possible that His yoke is perfect for you and His commandments are not burdensome? How is it unless He Himself puts on flesh? He Himself dwells among us. He Himself carves His own yoke to put upon His shoulders, to take your sin, to put upon His mantle and make atonement for you so that truly the yoke that you're going to put on is His yoke, and it is light, and His burden is easy. His commandments, friends, are not burdensome because we have a friend that comes alongside of us in His commandments and says, I'm commanding you to do this, and I'm going to push you the entire way. I'm going to progress you. I'm going to sanctify you. I'm going to draw you to myself. I'm going to equip you more than you can understand naturally. I'm going to give you spiritual gifts to attend to these needs that look overwhelmingly large that you cannot attain over. And I am going to progress you as the captain of your salvation. His commandments are not burdensome. This is true, if I can be real with you, this is true in my own testimony. I never thought in my wildest dreams that I would ever be a missionary.
Most honestly, I never, whenever I was in junior high or elementary school and there was a visiting missionary and they were talking about going in the wilds of Africa or going to Europe or so on and so forth, I always thought, wow, that's some really great stories, but it never applied to me because I never felt called to it. But the Lord has better plans, His better commandments, and they're not burdensome. And what I thought might have been just a 3-month internship in Europe turned out to be 8 years on the mission field. 3 months turning into 8 years as the Lord starts to move and fashion me and saying, I'm going to push you a little bit more into your discomfort, a little bit more into your discomfort, a little bit more into your discomfort. And you take a stand back and you look at 8 years and says, the Lord has always been faithful. And His commandments are not burdensome. Coming back to the States here after those 8 years in ministry, I just simply have to look at my wife and 3 children to say, Lord, wow, it's a blessing. It's an honor to serve You all the days of my life. He has always remained faithfulness. And to be able to come a life filled with testimonies of His enduring faithfulness. Friends, His commandments might be hard, but they're not burdensome. The love of God makes these commandments not a burden. It's as if to say, well, stepping back, on Tuesday nights, we have a men's study. Clock in, man up. It's at Tuesday nights at 7 o'clock. All you guys are always welcome to come, and it's a great time praying for one another, studying God's Word. And we're doing a series in Genesis right now, and we're looking at the life of Jacob. And here in Genesis chapter 29, Jacob goes to Laban, and he finds Rachel, right? We know the story. He goes to Laban, he finds Rachel, and he ends up working for Laban for 7 years in order that he might marry her. And I love the text it shows here in Genesis 29, verse 20. Jacob loved Rachel, and he said, oh, it skipped over. We'll stay right there, verse 20. Jacob, no, go ahead and go back to verse 20. That's great. So Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and here's the mind-blowing thing. And they seemed to him but a few days because of the love that he had for her. This is what makes His commandments unburdensome, the love that we have, the relationship of love that we have for God. No matter what obstacle we face, we know that we're in the safe hands of our Creator and our Savior. Those years seem like a few days to Him because of His love He had for Rachel. Lord Jesus, my prayer for myself, my prayer for this congregation is that our love for You would make the hardship of Your commandments seem like a few days in the response of years under You. Let's move on. We need to keep going. Verses 6 through 9. This is He, Jesus, who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. Not by the water only, but by the water and the blood. And the Spirit is the one who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. For there are 3 that testify, the Spirit and the water and the blood, and these 3 agree. If we receive the Spirit of men, the testimony of God is greater, for this is the testimony of God that He has borne concerning His Son. What John is saying here is because of Jesus Christ, you are a new creation. As he's enumerated many, many times, you are now born of God. No longer born of men. You are born of God. And the result of that is that you have overcome the world of the flesh. You've overcome the world of the devil. You've overcome the world of the lust of the eyes and the pride of life because Jesus has overcome on your behalf. When you think about this, when a conquering king overwhelms a nation, takes it by force, conquers it, and establishes it in his kingdom, what happens to his baby child? That baby child shares in that victory. And what has the baby child done in order to advance that victory for the kingdom? Absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing. The only reason that he gets to share in the victory of his father, the conquering king, is because he's the son of the king. And if you believe in the Son of God, Jesus Christ, as it's proclaimed here in verse 6, then you are a son of the king. For there are these three that testify, the Spirit and the water and the blood, for these three agree. And if we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God is greater. For this is the testimony of God that he has borne concerning his Son. Verse 6 is somewhat interesting, however. What does John mean when he says that Jesus came by water and blood? Essentially, he's proclaiming to us that there's three evidences, three witnesses that proclaim that Jesus came as God to men for salvation. Notice that there in verse 7, there's three that testify. Spirit, water, and blood, these three agree. Let's just kind of unfold that real quickly. Water, as the first witness. If you're taking notes, you can number it 1 through 3. First one is water. This is speaking of John the Baptist baptizing Jesus. And we remember from the gospel what happens. As he's baptized, we see that perfect visual picture of the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We see the Son rising out of the water. We hear the voice of God the Father saying, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." And then we see that visual representation of the Holy Spirit, the dove coming down. The Messiah chose to take part in John the Baptist's baptism to identify himself as being human, as having flesh, so that all humankind would be able to understand and know, "I am one amongst you." That's the reason of the witness of the water. Secondly, there's the witness of the blood, meaning he came by blood through his death, standing in our place as guilty sinner, taking punishment for our sin deserved. So the water represents his flesh. The blood represents that he's the Messiah. And then, of course, here in the third witness, there's the Holy Spirit. As God himself, the Spirit, bears the testimony that his power has raised Jesus Christ from the dead, and thus we all as well in him. All of those testify that Jesus was indeed man, Jesus was indeed God, and that he truly died and rose again. He identifies with us in every way. Now, this is somewhat interesting that I think we need to take a moment to just mention here. Verse 7 and 8, this is something good for us as apologetics, as believers in Christ. Verse 7 and 8, the explanation is not in the original Greek manuscript. It's not in the original text of John's letter. So it means that someone else other than John wrote verses 7 and 8. What we understand in church history is that in the 11th century, when people were translating the Bible, they would translate it from Latin rather than the original Greek. And so in doing so, someone, while they're translating the New Testament, thought, you know, it's important that I put in the margins here, verses 7 and 8, just to clarify what John is saying. And as the centuries went on into the 13th century, that little clarification moved from the margins actually into the text there. I mean, this is important because it speaks about the Trinity. It speaks about Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And especially when we talk to our Jehovah Witnesses, our neighbors, and we share with them about the love of Jesus Christ and the love of the Trinity, well, what they're going to say is that there is no such thing as the Trinity. And there's a possibility, there's a capacity to say, well, no, check this out. Look at verse 7 and 8. There it is. There's the Trinity. And they'll say, aha! Let me share with you first. That's not in the original manuscript. You better know your Bible, right? Friends, take a look at the previous verses and the verse right after that. Verse 6, this is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ, there's the Son. Not by the water only, but by the water and the blood, and the Spirit, there's the Holy Spirit, is the one who testifies because the Spirit is the truth. Down to verse 9, if we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God, the Father is greater. There's your Trinity right there. Whoever does not believe God has made him a liar because he has not believed in the testimony that God has borne concerning his Son. Friends, this shouldn't make us concerned in any fashion at all, okay? This is simply a clarification of what's being understood here in the text. We could remove verses 7 and 8 from the text there and have complete clarity that the Trinity is still present. I just want to give you guys assurance in that. So, continuing on, verses 10 through 12. Whoever believes in the Son, excuse me, let's start at 9. If we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God is greater, for this is the testimony of God that he has borne concerning his Son. Whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself, and whoever does not believe God, God has made him a liar, because he has not believed in the testimony that God has borne concerning his Son. And this is the testimony that God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. Friends, this is the gospel. This is the good news of Jesus Christ. Whoever has the Son has life and life eternal in him. And whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. There, right there in verse 12, if you take one word out of that sentence, it removes itself from being the good news of Jesus. Every word in its most efficient manner, whoever, right? That means all people have the opportunity to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Whoever has the Son has life. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you have life eternal. And then it goes back again, whoever, meaning all people having that opportunity, does not have the Son of God, does not have life. This is good news. This is news worth proclaiming, worth telling, worth running around the world and proclaiming for, because it's firstly the testimony from God. He has chosen to share this with us, share this good news in order that we might be able to testify that good news to all people. To give you an illustration, who's run a marathon here? One, two, three. Great. As you guys totally can tell by me, I don't have a marathon body at all. And so it took me some research into understanding really what the cost of running a marathon is. But if I'd like to share you just real quickly, a marathon. It's the word that we use for running, and specifically running an allotted length of miles. And the origin of this word, as we're coming to the conclusion here, the order of this word is interesting. Marathon, the word marathon, comes from the Grecian Empire, from the Greek Empire. And there was a time when the Greeks were fighting the Persians. And there was a battle at a city not far from Athens, the city called Marathon, okay? And these Greeks won the battle against the Persians at the city of Marathon. And it came to be the point that they won such a strategic victory that there needed to be the news of this victory sent to Athens. So what did they say? They looked for a guy who had a runner's body. Hey, friend, run to Athens. Go tell everybody about the victory that we've won against the Persians at Marathon. So this guy ran, and there's actual distance understood, 26 miles, ran 26 miles or so to Athens to declare what? News of victory. Good news. And I can imagine such good news that it motivated the man to run like he's never run before. Those 26 miles into the gates, into Athens, into the emperor to proclaim, we've won this victory over the Persians. Now let me ask you a question. What would happen if the runner got there and there were those who didn't believe him? Who didn't believe what he said? How do you know that we've won a victory? How do you know? What would happen to them? Their fault would be double. Let me tell you how their fault would be double. How? Number one, they are faulted because they can't share in the joy of a victory over an enemy because of good news. Because they refuse it. They can't share in the joy of victory because of good news. And secondly, they're essentially calling the runner a liar, no matter what the evidence. When we're proclaiming that good news, we're sharing. We want people to share in the joy of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And they can't share in that victory unless they believe it to be true. But also what they're essentially calling is not just you a liar, they're calling the testimony of God a liar when they're choosing to reject the opportunity of salvation. And friends, there's even a greater tragedy. There's even a greater, I would say, fear that's coming. Because friends, get this. Sooner or later, the victorious army is going to come home. That victorious army is going to come home, those 26 miles, with blood-soaked armor, being led by the victorious general on a white horse, proclaiming as they're entering into the city, we have overcome. We have declared ourselves victorious against those that would wish to depose us. And all of those who chose to reject the runner's good news, it will be too late for those liars to find their footing. God has given us eternal life, and eternal life only through Jesus Christ, the one who has won the victory for us. So friends, if you believe you have the good news of testimony in Jesus, we must realize this. Your testimony is only possible because God's testimony has proven to be true. He has revealed it to you. He has caused it to change your life, not just in the temporal, but in the eternal. He has changed your destiny to enter into a kingdom that you do not deserve to be called a citizen of. But by His grace and mercy, by His conquering of death and sin upon the cross, He has given you access to not only become a citizen, but become a child of the King. He has revealed it to us, so we have a cause to run. And friends, we're able to run with unburdened obedience to declare it. Time is short. Friends, the general, he's coming home soon. He's going to return on his white horse, and he's going to establish his kingdom, no matter who says what. Friends, we need to be the runners that proclaim his coming. Amen. Let's pray. And let's ask God to strengthen us, encourage us to do that. Lord Jesus, first of all, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it's living and powerful. We thank you, Lord Jesus, truly the honor and the privilege of having a Bible just even sitting in our laps right now. Lord, we cannot estimate the true value of what it means to have Old and New Testament in our hands. Your very voice open to us if we just crack open your word. Lord, all of these truths, all of these promises, Lord God, Lord, they mean nothing if we don't choose to follow you. If we don't choose to confess our sin, to repent of our sin, and to proclaim, Jesus, you are truly the conquering King. Not only have you conquered sin, but you've conquered me. I acknowledge, Lord God, that I've not just been neutral in the war against good and evil, but I've in fact been a rebel against the victorious King. And I thank you, Father, that you held your hand, and in turn of giving me a fist, giving me judgment that I've deserved, you've opened your hand to say, come. Become a citizen, become a child of the living God. Lord, I know that I don't deserve this. Lord, I know that my past might scream out, you don't deserve this. But the good news of Jesus Christ, the victory that he has overcome sin, is saying your past is behind you. It's free and clear under the blood of Jesus Christ. all you simply have to say, I confess and I believe. Lord, above all things, we want to love you, knowing that in the best way we can love one another, we love and obey you. Lord, we thank you, God, that we can be reminded of this, we can be encouraged by this. Lord God, please, Lord Jesus, don't let it fall on fallow ground, but on good soil within our hearts, that I may be planted and it might give the increase for your kingdom, the increase for your church here, the increase for this congregation, in order that we might be ready with authentic confidence, ready to run the race of faith, because we know you're coming back soon. Lord, we can't wait for that, Lord Jesus. We cannot wait for you to come and return for your bride. But Lord, in the meantime, we want to be ready and we want to be willing to obey your commandments, because we know they're unburdensome. So Lord, do that within our hearts, Lord. You know our weaknesses, you know our faults, you know our flaws. Use us in spite of them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. If you'd like prayer, feel free to come up. We'd love to pray for you for any need that you might have.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that broadcast. I pray that the Word of God affected your life and will go forth from your head to your heart and begin to affect your family, affect your neighborhood, affect your workplace. We welcome you to join us on Sunday mornings at 8:30 and 10:30, but only if you're not attending a church elsewhere in this community. I welcome you also to consider how the Lord would use you with this word and in his spirit to do something eternal in these last days. God bless you. Once again, this is Paul Berry, senior pastor of Calvary Chapel.